In dedicating the building in 1905, Judge William Morrow concluded by saying, "It is the duty of the courts to administer justice to all alike, whether rich or poor, great or small. The building cannot determine with what success this duty will be performed. Injustice and wrong may emanate from a palace, while right and justice may come from a hovel. As the poet said, for justice, all place a palace, all season, summer."
It's true that this building is in itself inspiring, and everybody who sees it, they tell me what a beautiful building I have. I tell them, it's not mine, it's yours.
If you look at old pictures of Judge Browning, and present pictures and mid pictures, you see a great calmness in his eyes. And it was that sense of wisdom that he communicated to people, of good humor. He has a perfect match of heart and mind, something that made him a great judge, but also made him a great leader of the court. And he rose to become one of the most successful chief judges in the nation, in our history.
He set an example, I think, for everybody in this building, that we were here to serve the public.
When he was a kid, he was known first as Tiny because of his stature, but then he became known as Tuffy when he was hit by an axe accidentally. Blood spurted, but no tears. And then later on in law school, that nickname continued. He's lost that moniker now. Well, I'll just call him Judge.
There was one day early in my clerkship, the three-judge panel that we were sitting on cast their votes in a case, and one of the judges circulated a draft opinion. So I rushed into Judge Browning's office and I said, "Judge, we have to do something about this. We need to fix this. We need to send them a memo right away." And Judge Browning just looked at me and he smiled and he said, "Okay, write a memo, but play soft music for them."
If you really go down the major innovations in court administration over the last 30 to 40 years, you'll find that most of the innovations started through the creative mind of Judge Browning. We had email in the Ninth Circuit 20 years before anybody had heard the term, and this is from a judge who has never been able to operate a computer.
I remember one time before I worked for Judge Browning, I saw him walking down the alley, and I thought, oh my gosh, I wouldn't even walk down that alley. "Hello, friend," he always says, hello, friend, nobody bothered him. Everybody knows Judge Browning.
He grew up in the small town of Belt, Montana, about 500 people.
On the first Thursday, after Pearl Harbor, the Belt Valley Times had one of the few headlines in its history, "Little Likelihood Belt Will Be Bombed." I loved that story all my life.
He always would say the only reason he got to be a federal judge was because he was the clerk of the Supreme Court and held the Bible when John F. Kennedy took office.
"Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So help you God.
So help me God."
I didn't lay it to my pure brilliance. Mr. Nixon and Mr. Eisenhower. It's a very pleasant place to work, and it's quiet, it's beautiful, and everybody loves it. But I still think that if I were doing my work from my front porch or living room, I would love the work just the same.
I think when anyone walks the doors of this building, they feel a sense of justice, a sense of majesty. When we entered courtroom one, history seems to come off the walls. We know the cases that have been argued there, the cases that have been heard over time.
On a single day, you might see immigration, antitrust, some international law question involving the borders, an insurance case, a discrimination case.
Since Hollywood is in the circuit, we often get disputes about movies and the like. I mean, it's such a different mix from everyday bank robbers to huge fishing cases.
It's an ongoing process. Every year brings a new harvest of fish.
And the question is, how is this going to be administered?
The Henry Miller obscenity case was argued here. The books themselves were seized at the port by customs agents. And a member of the ACLU brought suit on behalf of the books and said these books are literature. But the trial court judge ordered the books destroyed. It was appealed to the three judges of the Ninth Circuit, who agreed and said in a famous quote, "The great mass of the people still believe there is such a thing as decency." President Eisenhower agreed, and he signed a writ of destruction, and the books were burned right here in the building.
Looking at that 100 years of the Ninth Circuit, whatever's happening in society, we are in some cases, we're just a reflection of that.
Emiliano Santiago asks this court to declare illegal the involuntary extension of his enlistment contract with the Army National Guard.
I sit with three judges out of our 28. We all have the same objective, to follow the law, do justice so far as the law allows. You go through the material, hear the arguments, to arrive at a sound conclusion.
That counsel is ready to present argument.
You know, the work we do, every ounce of energy we bring to the job, I hope is to bring faster, better, more correct justice to people. It's justice itself that is being honored.
And it isn't what I think it ought to be, it's what the law and the evidence that was in the case indicates it ought to be.
I remember thinking that there was a strain through his cases, and I think it's a strain that I see in the court and I see in myself, which is to assure court access.
Good afternoon. Please be seated.
What matters is that people get into court and get heard. I tell myself every day, and I know all my colleagues do, that each of the cases is about real people and their lives and is entitled to an enormous amount of attention and gets it.
It's the biggest federal circuit in the country.
When Judge Browning came on this court in 1962, there were 300 cases a year. Now with 16,000 cases a year, it's a challenge. We hear all of those kinds of disputes that people have in the West. And that's the life of our geographic area. In fact, if you look at history and what's happened in this very building, you find there's an echo and an answer. And when we hear immigration cases, many of them harken back to the immigration cases that were heard in this very courthouse years before.
Now, at the time, under the Chinese Exclusion Act, Miss Asu is a young Chinese girl who was trafficked into the United States by basically a gangster. But in fact, she was a slave to him. And at some point, she escaped her master. And she found herself in a home for Chinese girls in Portland, Oregon, because, of course, she had come into the country illegally. The immigration authorities put her on the list for deportation. It was a sad story because she would go back to being a slave in China. The Ninth Circuit acknowledged the very difficult position she was in and said, unfortunately, there really was no legal means or theory that would support her staying. She was sent back to China. And that's the last we know about Asu.
One of the great dualities in the law is to follow the strict language of the law as opposed to doing what the judges think is the compassionate, you know, humane, just thing. And that's an eternal tension in the law that A, never will be resolved, and B, shouldn't be resolved.
There are constant little reminders in the building of his history, of his intentions. There are famous metaphors in the Redwood Room, carvings of the north wind, which are reputed to be blowing the cool air of reason into the space. There are owls that are carved to suggest, of course, the ever-presence of wisdom in the space.
I like to talk about the light bulbs, because remember, 1905, the electric light bulb was the latest technology.
The materials in this building are really pretty extraordinary. It is a virtual encyclopedia of wood species, and likewise stone.
The marble comes from all over the nation and all over the world. Spain, France, Italy, and Tennessee pink marble, and Georgia gray.
and there is granite on the exterior, and we have lions' heads outside, and each lion has a pink terracotta tongue.
It is actually one of the great masterworks of craftsmanship of this last century. An authentic representation of culture at that time.
From 1905 to 1966, this building was both the district court and the Court of Appeals, as well as having U.S. attorney's offices and the post office. Post office bank and safes in the building that held gold. So it was designed to have great numbers of the public come and see it every day.
When it opened, Sunset Magazine said it's a post office that's a palace. And at the time, it cost $2.5 million. Which was a lot of money in those days. They brought over hundreds of craftsmen from Italy who spent 7 years setting up tents, you know, around the periphery, cutting the marble, carving the wood, laying the tile.
It's a very interesting bringing together of American, kind of a pioneer spirit almost, and celebration of American land and agriculture within this very traditional classical shape.
I think it's the idea that San Francisco doesn't have that many pieces of its history that go as far back as this building in 1906. It was surrounded by light industrial buildings, mostly wooden stables and blacksmiths and very poor hotels. And everything was destroyed because after the earthquake, the fire swept in two directions, east from Van Ness Avenue and it came west from the bay.
The Redwood Room was completely burned during the 1906 fire, and only valiant postal workers damping out the fire with their mail bags kept that fire from sweeping through the rest of the courthouse.
My father had a trucking company, a draying company they called it in those days, and he was in charge of the relief effort for San Francisco and fed 3,000 men a day, and the building stood.
People came inside and slept in the hallways. The post office held the building open 24 hours a day so people could see that there still was a functioning federal government. This building is still serving its original purpose of serving the public and being here to do justice and as a symbol of the importance of the federal government to people.
Chadha versus INS was a very important case. It's a wonderful story that a foreigner, an alien, a person not a citizen of the United States can come to the United States court and sue and say your legal framework that you're using to deport me is unconstitutional. This is marvelous. And Chadha prevailed in the case that we decided here and that I wrote and that was later affirmed in the Supreme Court. And some 1 or 2 years later, I was on Van Ness Avenue in San Francisco, and I was in Tower Records to buy some CDs. And I picked out a couple CDs and gave the clerk my MasterCard. And he said, are you Anthony Kennedy, the judge on the Ninth Circuit? And I said, yes. He said, I'm Chadha, the guy you let stay in the country. Here, take all the records. Take all, what do you want, pop, reggae, classical? So he was very excited. But that just shows you that our law has a human dimension. This made a difference to someone's life.
On October 17, 1989, the Loma Prieta earthquake struck the San Francisco Bay Area. Along with landslides, ruptures, and fires, the 6.9 magnitude earthquake destroyed nearly 12,000 homes and 2,600 businesses.
The San Francisco In courtroom Bay one, they had been cleaning the mosaics. The earthquake hit, I think, at around 5 o'clock, and around 5:01, that contractor got out of here fast. This building really shook.
Hollow clay tiles crumbled, cracked. Building was red tagged, unfit for human habitation, closed. So big choice, do we just let it sit, or do we come up with the money to renovate and retrofit?
Dick Chambers has loved this building ever since he was appointed to the bench here. And he's a persevering, stubborn character. I would credit him for our staying here.
He was never really stumped by an attorney. And when my children first saw the Great Hall, as we call it, they asked Chief Judge Chambers if they could bring their rollerblades and roll. That stumped him. He was wondering if he should start that as a precedent.
Most of the furniture in this building, Dick stole from other federal courthouses where they were tearing them down. When you go out in that hall, you'll see some very handsome lights on the walls. That came, I think, from Chicago, courthouse there.
He would gather up all the furniture, all the lighting fixtures. He'd load it up into the van and bring it back to San Francisco and Pasadena. So at one point, I'm exaggerating a little bit, there was a headline in the Chicago Tribune that said, "Robber Judge makes off with priceless treasures."
It's very fashionable to talk about sustainability today, but often that means green roofs and so forth. But in fact, sustainability is, at its heart, preserving our culture, preserving our historic resources for the future. It was a daunting question in the beginning to think about taking a building that had such significance in the city of San Francisco from being a combination post office, federal office building, and courts into strictly used by the Ninth Circuit.
Congress really passed special legislation to allow this building to be refurbished. It was a hefty price tag, close to $100 million. A great deal of time was put in to looking at what the building had looked like and trying to restore it as close as we could. It was renovated with the future in mind.
First challenge was to stabilize the building in a way that in future seismic events, the building might not only survive, but also be operational, which we did with a process we call base isolation. Essentially isolating the base of the building from the earth, really cut a building free from its foundations. We wanted to preserve extraordinary interiors. It had become a very darkened space because in World War II, all the skylights had been blackened. So the first goal was to find ways to breathe life back in this building, to bring light back. We discovered that we could actually create a usable basement area, 50,000 square feet of space that's contemporary and yet sympathetic with the historic building. Place of real public accessibility.
It was a great day when Congress passed legislation naming this building after Judge Browning, because to me, it exemplifies everything that's great about the law: honor, decency, respect, fairness. And Judge Browning is all of that. And every time I come in the building, those are the things I think about.
This building is a wonderful place to work. Yes, it's a lovely, lovely place, but it's the work you're doing. I think it's a great court. I think it's one of the most creative courts in the country. It's true.
We have a lot of judges who are quite liberal. We have quite a number who are conservative, and most judges are somewhere in the middle. And I think that's healthy. It's always important to have a mix of ideas.
I think that's one of the geniuses of Judge Browning, is he was able to take people who were different ideologically, of perhaps different temperamentally, and bring the court together in a unified fashion.
There is no institution without the people. We are really blessed to have dedicated people, people who want to do their job, people who want to serve the public. I've been very fortunate to have had wonderful chief judges before me who set a standard, going back to Judge Browning and before, all who've had a great vision, and the institution reflects that leadership.
As the saying goes, there are mountains behind mountains. We're going to face new challenges every year, and ones we don't expect. But the foundation of this court is very strong. We have a packed week, and that means every day you read a stack of briefs, talk to your law clerks, think about the cases, get prepared for the oral argument and to write opinions, but also reserve time for some of the bigger questions, the questions that are going to implicate a lot of cases down the road. I think we have a very bright future, and the work of the court goes on.